Hello, everybody. I guess this is, I think, one of the first institute seminar in days or weeks or months when I'm not talking about my own work. This is a very big body of work. It's an entire group of people. And I am just going to show a lot of pretty pictures, and I'm not going to go into details because, of course, the time involved. So anyway, so here, let's start here. So you don't care about that. So the first question, I mean, which is was asked in the title, how does the sun shine? A beautiful photo taken with the ISS in the foreground. How does the sun shine? So we know the answer to this question. We know that the sun shines through nuclear fusion. This is something that we learned in school. And nuclear fusion means that the sun shines due to hydrogen fusing into helium in the solar core. And hydrogen, if you look at the nucleus of hydrogen, is nothing but protons. And so you can see that there are four protons on the left-hand side of this equation, and there's a helium nucleus on the right-hand side. And apart from the helium, there are two more objects, that is the positron over here, and the particle that we are interested in, which is the neutrino. And then there's, of course, some energy. So let's go over this equation one by one. So as I said, hydrogen nucleus is just a proton, and helium has two protons and two neutrons. So there are four objects in the left-hand side, which are inside the nucleus, and four objects on the right-hand side, which are inside the nucleus. And this goes by the fancy name of baryon number conservation. Doesn't really matter, but just to keep track. Now you can see that the proton has, therefore four protons have four plus charges. And whereas there are only two protons inside the helium, so you're short of two positive charges. And therefore you have over here, the positron, which has two positive charges, and therefore, you have charge conservation. And finally, over here, you have, just like you had baryons, which are inside, sitting inside the nucleus, those things which don't sit inside the nucleus, for example, the electron is called a lepton. So you have an anti-electron, and therefore you need to have some other particle which balances that quantum number, and therefore you needed the neutrino. This is a way of seeing it. And this is the kind of hero of our story that we'll come back to in a little while. Just to finish this equation, it's an exothermic process. Energy is released in this fusion process, and eventually this is seen as sunlight, and that means that totally you have energy momentum conservation. So this is our entire equation, the physics chemistry of it all satisfied. And I just want to highlight for those of you who have not seen this unit, it's called million electron volts. And this is about 2 million times the energy which is required, not when, but to ionize a hydrogen atom. So when a hydrogen atom loses its electron, it gets ionized, it becomes a hydrogen ion. And that's very, very small fraction of the energy which is released in this process. That's why nuclear reactions release a lot of energy. And therefore, there's a huge amount of sunlight. So all you need to do is go outside, which of course we're not supposed to do nowadays. But if you go outside and measure the amount of sunlight falling on the Earth, you can compute back and ask how much energy was emitted by the sun. And for every 25 MeV of energy, there should have been two neutrinos. That's where we are in this. Now, before I go on, since I introduced so many names, lepton, baryon, and so on, I will just focus on really what is the particle content of our universe, but in a very simple sub-region of just the leptons. So just to go quickly over, I already mentioned baryons. So you can see the way to look at it is to look at our favorite interactions. We all know electromagnetic interactions. Strong interactions are what holds the nucleus together. And weak interactions are typically what I saw in the sun, the fusion processes in the sun, as well as, for example, radioactivity. And you can see that the proton actually has all these interactions, okay? Whereas the electron doesn't sit inside the nucleus, and therefore it doesn't have strong interactions, okay? And the neutrino, in fact, being the most interesting of all, has only weak interactions because it has no charge either. So with this very short introduction to what these particles are, and particles like these make up our universe all. Fraction of our universe. And to focus more on the leptons, because they are interesting to us, the neutrinos come in, and in fact the leptons, so these are like partners, the electron and its neutrino, and I've written it in a more formal sense here. You can see that I have an electron and a neutrino, and just like this, which is called a generation, there's a muon, which is a heavier version of the electron and its neutrino, and a tau and its neutrino. And we don't know whether there are more generations, possibly unlikely. Why they exist, we don't know. Only the electron participates in normal matter. I mean, you and I are made up of electrons. We don't contain mu or tau. So that's just because the electron is the lightest object, the other two objects decay. And the main thing is to focus on is that there are three types of neutrons. And the one that is produced inside the sun is the new E neutron. Okay. And all these neutrons were considered to be massless. Now, question. I said that if you just measure that much of sunlight, you can count the neutrinos, but there's a complicated process which I'm not going to go through. In red, you can see that the processes that are actually going on inside the sun produce neutrinos at different stages at different energies. So it becomes quite complicated to actually know what is the spectrum or the energy dependence of these neutrinos, and therefore it becomes a challenge to even measure them. So obviously the next question is, does the sun really shine in neutrinos? And the answer to this, of course, the proof of the pudding is to look for and to find these neutrinos. But the problem is that I said neutrinos have only weak interactions. And if they are weak interactions, they're called weak interactions because they are weak. And therefore, it's very difficult to actually observe these neutrinos. And people have been trying literally for decades. I think people have been trying for almost 50 years now, started as early as the 1960s, and they have eventually been successful. So let me just give you the answer in one summary page. The answer is that solar neutrinos have been seen, but they opened up some new exciting areas of research. So this is what the space says. The Nobel Prize was awarded to Davis and Kosiba for contributions to astrophysics, in particular for the detection of cosmic neutrinos. And about 10 years later or 13 years later, it was awarded for the discovery, a theoretical discovery was made by being buttressed by an experimental observation by McDonald and Kajita that neutrinos are actually not massless, but they have mass. And this is the story that we are going to see. Okay, so a technical point which everybody can ignore, but just for those in the physics group, is that neutrinos show quantum mechanical mixing and have non-zero mass, and both are required for this neutrino oscillations to occur, and this neutrino oscillation is really at the crux of this discovery. So what led to these discoveries is obviously the natural question, and here I'm going to highlight the three experiments, and I'm going to go at the speed of light, and this is how they look. First, Davis was the first guy, as I said, who looked at these neutrinos. He actually just waited very passively with 600 tons of dry cleaning fluid, which contains chlorine. And whenever the chlorine captures a neutrino, it becomes an argon. He keeps counting the argon atoms, but he found that he didn't see neutrinos, but he found that the number of events which were expected were three times larger than the observed observed number. And the index I have written here doesn't matter at all, except that the new E becomes an electron. So it becomes a neutral particle, has become a charged particle. So it's called a charge current interaction. However, nobody could guarantee that these neutrinos were from the sun. It's a passive experiment. The neutrinos could be coming from anywhere. And this question was answered by Kosiba and his collaborators, which is why they jointly got the Nobel Prize, where he did some other experiment. And all I want you to remember is that it's scattering on electron. And this electron just is kicked in the forward direction. And because it's kicked in the forward direction, it's a real-time experiment. You can actually work backwards and see that these neutrinos have come from the sun. As you see, cos theta, theta is the angle with respect to the sun. And actually, there's a peak in that direction. So these are indeed solar neutrinos. So you have seen solar neutrinos. But again, the ratio of the expected to observe is about a half. So it's not one. So you have solar neutrinos, but they are less in number. And this puzzle was solved. There are many other parts to the puzzle. But this puzzle was solved by saying that we remember neutrinos came in three types. You remember nu E, nu mu, and nu tau. For simplicity, let me consider two of them. And let me write this nu E and nu mu. I can rotate it into another basis, which is called the mass basis, where I have nu 1, nu 2, and of course, nu 3 will be the mass eigenstates. And there will be a mixing matrix, which matches the flavor basis to the mass basis. And if this theta is non-zero, since nu E is an admixture of two different mass eigenstates, what happens is if you look at this graph, you can start out with some proportion of these nu 1 and nu 2, and because they're quantum mechanical, as they evolve in time, they are moving at different frequencies, and therefore they separate out. And you can see at a certain time, you have only a completely blue state. At some other time, you have a completely red state. So what you observe on Earth will depend on the distance that these particles have traveled. And therefore, the neutrino oscillation scenario, if true, requires this non-zero values of this mixing angles, and also requires that they should have different masses. And they should have different masses. Okay, so how do you know that this theory is true? The final denouement came from the snow detector, where they measured actually three different channels. They measured something which was analogous to what Davis measured. They got the same answer. They measured something analogous to what Super K measured, the Koshiba experiment in Japan. They got the same answer. They also managed to measure with an extremely beautiful experiment all the neutrinos coming from the sun, and they got the ratio of observed to expected events to be one. Hence, we now understand that the neutrinos are doing precisely what they are expected to do. The sun shines exactly as we believe it to shine. But when the neutrinos are propagating from the sun to the earth, they are doing something funny. They are undergoing oscillations because they mix. And this is something new in physics. And this is what a lot of people are now trying to see. And they're trying to see from so many sources of neutrinos. And you can see that the energy in some units goes from 10 to the power of minus 4 to 10 to the power 18, some 20 orders of magnitude. And many of these sources of neutrinos, especially the solar neutrinos I already talked about, atmospheric, supernova, accelerator, are all being probed in various experiments across the world. So that is exactly the same thing in text, so I'm not going to talk about it. So now what is it that we know after all these studies? Here is a graph. Please look at the graph over here on the right-hand side. The schematic, which has red, blue, and green, are the admixtures of nu e, nu mu, nu tau in the mass eigenstates m1, m2, and m3. And you can see that the contribution, the contribution of the red color in m3 is really small. And that is indicated by the fact that one mixing angle is very small, the other two mixing angles are large. But the more important question is that we don't know whether M3 was the most massive or the lightest mass eigenstate. So this is called the mass ordering problem, or leads to something called the hierarchy problem. So this is one outstanding question in neutrino physics. The other question is that if you have a 3x3 mixing matrix, you also have a phase. And this phase actually physically has a lot of meaning. It indicates the difference between the interaction of neutrinos and antineutrinos with matter. So it distinguishes in some sense between matter and antimatter. And it's a very important property of all matter, because if you look around us, it's a very indirect point, I'll just say it very briefly. If you look around, you see that the universe is made up of so many galaxies, which are all made up of matter. We have not yet seen any antimatter galaxies. But if you believe that the universe began in the Big Bang, there must have been equal amount of matter and antimatter in our world. And so where has all the antimatter gone? There must have been something in the interactions of matter and antimatter which caused the antimatter to evolve away faster than the matter. So we are left behind with matter dominant galaxies. And it's possible that this delta Cp, which is a parameter of the neutrino mixing matrix, can eventually help to answer this puzzle. I won't talk about it anymore, but I just wanted to introduce two parameters. One is the question of whether M3 is the lightest or the heaviest mass eigenstate, and that which is called the mass ordering or the mass hierarchy. And the other is the delta Cp. And the whole topic was being introduced to talk about the India-based neutrino observatory, which is a proposal to build an underground neutrino lab in India to study some of these neutrino properties. So I'm going to start now about the INO project. It's a proposed project, it's not nowhere near construction. It's funded. Its main goal is to create an underground laboratory to do research in neutrino physics. So the first question is, why underground? If you put a neutrino lab on the surface, there's a huge natural cosmic ray background on the Earth's surface, because cosmic rays are very mysterious objects. A lot of research is going on about them as well. But they're just mostly protons, other nuclei which keep hitting the Earth, coming from outer space, and that will act as that would completely swamp your neutrino signal if you put it on the surface. So if you go underground, the charged particles are absorbed by Earth, because you know that Earth is always Earth's the charged particles, and therefore all neutrino labs are underground. And this has caused huge problems, because when you put something underground and it's funded by the DAE, then a lot of people wonder what you're really going to do over there, and I'll just mention this towards the end. So the main detector that we want to put in the lab is called the ion calorimeter detector, and the key point about this detector, which we call ICAL for short, is that it is magnetized. So I'll just talk about that a little later. And there is a Center for Particle Physics at Madurai, which is functioning right now. Okay. So what is this ICAL detector? So very, very difficult to put get the iCal detector in any beautiful frame because it's a very, very inconvenient size. It's a very huge detector. If built, when built, it will be the most massive detector in the world. Magnetized iron so that you can magnetize it. It will be about 5 stories high, roughly the size of Chennai Airport, actually. Okay, it's about 5 stories high. It's just layers of iron interleaved by some active detector. It doesn't matter what it's called. Let's talk of it as RPC. So the active detectors are RPCs. They will see the charge signal, and the iron is just providing a huge mass, just like the dry cleaning fluid of Davis or the water of Kamioka was the heavy mass with which the neutrino can interact. So here we have a very compact but large detector which is made of iron, and just to give you a size of the scale of the problem, it requires a magnetic field of 1.5 Tesla, and the RPC units, you remember I talked about RPC units, are about 30,000 of 2 meter by 2 meter each glass RPCs, which are really very heavy, and you'll need about 4 million channels of electronics. And so it's a huge effort, not going to be built by one lab or two labs, by about 20 research institutions across India, about 100 not only scientists, but so many more technicians, electricians, engineers. And also it has a huge industry interface, which is already on, because it's the industry ultimately which is going to do this huge building of RPCs. But the entire R&D has been carried out in various labs across India. So I'll just show you a few pictures of that. But and then I will go on to what is the physics that we actually want to study. So here is what is there in Madurai. It doesn't matter what these are. You can see that a lot of stuff has been done and actually built locally and indigenously. A lot of students working on it. So all the electronics has also been designed and developed indigenously. So it's all ready. And this is the mini iCal detector, which is now functioning at Madurai. You can see the scale of the detector compared to the size of the people. This was last year's, was it last year? Yeah, last year. Last year's summer program, a lot of students from Madurai colleges came and helped. You can see the size of one RPC, that's the size of one RPC, and that goes into this iCal detector and sees, and you can see the copper coils. If you can see the shining golden brown objects at the back is what gives you the magnetic field. So that's the detector, and as I said, a lot of students working on it. Here are the first cosmic ray muon events. You can see that events are there, and all the only reason I want to show again, if you look at it carefully, if you look at the top left corner, you can see that it's bending. The first two tracks are bending, and that's the reason you have a magnetic field. So what you have is that muon, being a minus charge particle, will bend in one direction. Mu plus, being a plus charge particle, will bend in a different direction, and therefore you'll be able to say whether you had a neutrino event or an antineutrino event, and that is the whole reason to have a magnetized detector. And what is it that we will learn when we build the ultimate large, not the mini version of the detector, but the actual detector? What we are going to look at is atmospheric neutrinos. What do atmospheric neutrinos do? The SuperK also has looked at atmospheric neutrinos, the self-same cosmic rays, which are such a problem for us. When they hit the atmospheric particles like nitrogen and oxygen in our atmosphere, they produce many, many particles, many more particles than I even talked about, which eventually decay and produce neutrinos. And these neutrinos, as you can see, these are the critical two processes. The neutrino interacting with iron nucleus, mostly muon neutrinos, will give you a mu minus in the detector. The mu antineutrino will give you a mu plus in the detector, and the magnetic field will differentiate between the two events, and therefore you can use this information to tell you whether you had a neutrino or an antineutrino. And really what you're interested in is you want to look at the neutrinos which are produced in the atmosphere on the other side of the Earth. They go through the entire Earth and then get detected in your detector. And as I said, this there will be a difference in the way neutrinos and antineutrinos interact. And this can be used to determine one of the unknown parameters, which is the mass ordering or the mass hierarchy, which is the position of the M3 eigenstate in this list of our massive neutrinos. So this is really what iCal wants to do. And there are, please don't read the first two parts. It's too technical, I realize. I don't want to go into it. But I just want to say that this is not something that only INO wants to do. Look at this list. You can see that it's many, many names. They're from all over the world. They're from Japan. They're from China. They're from, in fact, Ice Cube is in the Antarctic. So there are a huge number of experiments across the globe trying to probe, will or are probing the mass hierarchy. Each is an amazing experiment. However, most of these experiments will have to disentangle the CP, delta CP phase from the hierarchy phase measurement. So the two get entangled for certain technical reasons, but this is not true for INO. The ICAL experiment at INO will actually measure the hierarchy independent of the phase, and that is one unique selling point for INO. So please look at the bottom right photograph. If you look at the bottom right photograph, delta chi-square tells you if delta chi-square is small, it says it cannot discriminate some parameter. If delta chi-square is large, it says it can discriminate some parameter. So if you look at it here, the green line says that some other experiment called NOVA can discriminate delta CP. Can discriminate delta CP in part of the CP phase from 0 to 2 pi. But if you include the ICAL result, which is the red line, then it will be able to be sensitive to delta CP over the entire range of 0 to 2 pi. So there are additional synergies. So although INO may not be sensitive to the delta CP phase, in combination with other experiments, you will be able to actually make a much more sensitive measurement. And as I said, this may hold the key to understanding the matter content of our universe. It's a very important parameter. I'm not going to tell you about other things that INO can do. This is just the highlight of various things. So what is the status right now? As I already showed you, the mini ICAL is up and running. And right now, plans are on. So it has already been sanctioned and is going to be constructed now. A larger engineering prototype is ready for construction, which will just be 1/8 of a module, to make sure that, because ICAL has to be built in situ underground, you have to be sure that everything is in place and that will go in parts into the tunnel so that it can go in underground, and that engineering prototype is now ready for construction. It should take place over the next 2 years. Another very successful part of INO has been its graduate training program, which is now 11 years old. And in fact, among the first few batches of INO students, some are now faculty members, which is something we are very proud of. The bad parts of INO are what I'm just coming to now, that INO is planned to be located in the Theni district in Tamil Nadu. But because of its nature of being underground, there were many misconceptions about INO. People thought that, you know, anything underground will mean that you go to store nuclear waste there, so there'll be nuclear radiation. People are confused between neutrinos and neutrons. People believe that there'll be contamination of the water table, that there is a dam nearby, the Periyar Dam, and that's 35 kilometers away. And when you start digging your tunnel, that the dam will break. So there are many, many questions and problems about which we need to actually tell people that this is not true, and that INO is not going to be harmful either to people or to environment. Outreach is a continuous activity. It is ongoing. And in the meanwhile, legally also, we have faced challenges. The environmental clearance that was granted to INO was challenged in the National Green Tribunal. The appellant lost the case, but he has now taken it up in the Supreme Court, and the court case is now pending. Hopefully, it will get cleared. We are still hopeful of that. So that is the status. So I will end with an outlook. Neutrinos probe some of the most important frontiers of physics, astrophysics, and cosmology. So I didn't have time to tell you that the neutrinos, another reason why the Nobel Prize was given to the Kamioka experiment was that they also saw the neutrinos coming from a supernova explosion in 1987. So neutrinos are there everywhere. Neutrinos are the second most ubiquitous particle after photons in the universe. And therefore, people who are doing research on neutrino physics include people all the way from nuclear physics to particle physics to astrophysics and cosmology. But as far as particle physics is concerned, they're the cleanest probes of weak interactions. But they themselves have very exotic properties. The one property which I didn't talk about and I skipped was whether neutrinos are Majorana particles, which means that they are their own antiparticle. And they are the only fermions, because they are neutral, which have the possibility to be Majorana particles. And in fact, several experiments are on or being probed to or being built to probe whether this property of neutrinos is also true. So they're extremely exotic in their properties. But the other interest is that they are the key to understanding, as I said, many features about the origin and evolution of our universe. So they are interesting in that sense. So I believe that neutrinos are a new window into our universe. And I think 50 is an underestimate of experiments which are being devoted to study neutrinos from different sources. So we should remember that ICAL is only one of them, but it has its unique ability to separate neutrino and anti-neutrino events. That's because of its magnetic field. But we have been delayed. I think people who have been hearing me talk about INO for a long time now, it's been a long time in the making. I don't know whether INO will come before I retire, but the quest is on and we are still hopeful. We are not giving up hope. Never say die, I guess. So I also want to mention, which I didn't talk about at all, that there are other proposed experiments at INO, including one to look at this thing about whether neutrinos are its own their own antiparticles. So that's also an ongoing piece of work. And the community is very hopeful that issues will be resolved so that INO can finally become a reality. So I want to thank you here. I want to apologize that I showed you many, many beautiful experiments in 25 minutes without any experimental details. Each one is a very beautiful experiment, and the theories that have been proposed are also extremely beautiful. So if you want to know more about just the white paper of INO, which is the physics potential of ICAL, this is our paper. Please look at this paper. And there is also online, the official website of INO is hosted by TIFR, because TIFR is the host institute of INO. And it's also, you can see that INO is also active in COVID times, but all the details, including the theses that have come out of INO, various research work, clearances, judgments, news reports, everything is all over there. And I want to leave you with one message, that even though INO has been delayed so much, recently, last year, in fact, we asked for another international review. The first one was held many years ago, to ask whether, because of all these delays, whether INO physics is still viable, especially the ICAL detector. And we have this request was sent around to very well-known, highly, in fact, well-known physicists, experimental physicists across the world, and the answer from all of them has been yes. So I think that gives us hope, and this is the kind of ongoing saga. It doesn't stop here. It's open-ended and open beginning, and I will stop here. Thank you very much.
Thank you for the very wonderful outlook of what is currently going, the developments in India and in physics. So we have some time for anyone in the audience to ask questions.
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
So you said that some Japanese experiment detected neutrinos from the supernova explosion.
Yeah. Yeah.
What I don't understand in this is, are those neutrinos can they still be detected by us, or it has has the time, was it an event and you have to be at the right time and place?
Yes, you have to be in the right time and place, because you see, neutrinos are so light. There are many things I missed out after all 25 minutes, right? So neutrinos, even though they have mass which allows the particles to mix, these masses are very, very, very small. I mean, while the electron is 2000 times lighter than the proton, the neutrinos may well be million times lighter than the electron. And we still don't know what the absolute scale of masses are. We just know that they are different masses. Okay, we don't know what those masses are. Now, because these masses are so light, practically neutrinos travel at the speed of light. Which means that if the supernova which exploded was X light years away from us, then of course the neutrinos are going to reach us in X light years. Okay, I mean X years, because that's what a light year means. They're traveling at the speed of light, right? So this this was in the Large Magellanic Cloud, very nearby galaxy, so it was close by. So the neutrinos were detected in 1987, February 21st or 22nd, I don't remember, 1987. And then they're gone, push, they are still going. I mean, they're still there. They're just going to the other end of the universe, because so many of them are produced and hardly any have interacted with the detectors in our Earth. And the rest of them are simply streaming outwards. That's all. They will go to the ends of the universe. It's an amazing thing, actually, these neutrinos.
Yeah, I had one other, maybe possibly silly question. So you had this energies of various neutrinos, right? Or you had the solar neutrinos, cosmic neutrinos.
Yeah, sure.
So it makes sense to talk about the energy of a neutrino?
Yes, it does.
Neutrino energy, okay.
Yes. So it makes absolute sense to talk about energies of neutrinos, yeah.
But if they are all traveling, so this is what I'm puzzled by is so you...
Okay.
The same neutron can have different energies, or
No, so these are typical energies. That's why it's a scale. I mean, you can see that there's no dot. Okay. So for example, solar neutrinos, you can see that solar neutrinos, it says over here about 10 power 6. Okay. But if you look at these processes, okay, if you look at these processes, these neutrinos, which are first produced, are all less than about 0.2 million electron volts. And in the last case, this bottom right neutrinos are all about 10 to 15 million electron volts. Let's call it MeV. So this is 0.2 MeV. This is 10 to 15 MeV. So these are spectra. There's a range of neutrinos. But certainly you won't see solar neutrinos even at 20 or 30 MeV. You'll see them only at around up to 18 MeV. Similarly, supernova neutrinos are about 30 to 35 MeV. But if you look at the atmospheric neutrinos that INO is going to look at, they will all be thousands of MeV, thousands to ten thousands of MeV. And that you can see in this picture. Sorry. So maybe here you can see atmospheric is here. So that's 10 power 9. Yeah. So they have a different range. So the neutrinos which are produced in solar processes are of the order of 10 up to from 1 to tens of MeV. That's what it says. 10 power 6 EV is 1 MeV.
So the question is, so if I take a solar neutrino,
yeah,
meaning can it lose energy somehow? Is it possible for it to lose energy?
Yeah, cool. Nice question. So particles lose energy when they interact. So I hit a chalk against the wall, it loses energy and falls down, right? For that to happen, an interaction is happening. Actually, the chalk is having some electromagnetic interaction with the wall. But now this neutrino is not going to interact. It actually, so by the way, all these are rough numbers. When I say something, like for example, I say that a neutrino, typically a solar neutrino, can go through 7 Earth diameters without interacting even once. Okay. So the probability of interaction is really, really, really small. This is what you should understand. I mean, it's absolutely small compared to, for example, electromagnetic interactions. Right?
Okay.
And
I think
so
I
it doesn't lose energy. So what happens is that it can lose energy if it scatters off something, but that probability is very small. So what happens is that the probability that it interacts several times and lose a lot of energy before coming to our detector is practically zero. It does lose some energy, but not that much. Okay.
Yeah.
So you're right.
You said that there were some three types or something, but. Mm-hmm. Other than that, there is no difference between, you know, an atmospheric neutrino and a solar neutrino. They have different energies, I understand, typically.
Yes, that's all. But otherwise, they are the same type of neutrino, yes.
Yeah, okay. Got it.
They're just different sources of neutrinos. These are different sources of neutrinos.
Okay.
And different sources, yeah, produce different kinds of, I'm sorry, you know, I went at the speed of light, but you seem to have got a lot out of it, so I feel good. Thank you.
So, once again, I would thank the speakers for today's wonderful talks. And so I would like to call this session to a close. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much.